Your attorney would never tell you to smash a car window and get away with it, but I do on this episode of Unbillable. When you have a vlog about laws, every year you have one gimme episode, and that gimme episode is new laws. It's new laws for 2021. I warned you about a year ago that California makes new laws every single year, and only a few of them go away. So once again, here we are, 2021, right around the corner, new laws coming, a couple, very few going away. Let's not worry about the ones going away because they're going away. There are new laws coming, and let's start with minimum wage. The minimum wage continues to tick up. In California, the minimum wage, if you had less than, I think it was less than 25 employees, the minimum wage was 12, now it's gonna be 13. And if you had more than 25, I should say 26 or greater, it was 13 and it's going to 14. So minimum wage is ticking up. I should also make a small little note here that the California Family Rights Act is also gonna start applying to businesses with more than 5 employees. I think it used to apply to businesses with more than 50 employees. So now there's more companies, more businesses in California subject to the California Family Rights Act. If you don't know what that is, contact an employment lawyer. That's about all I know about this stuff. I literally just Googled what laws are going away December 31, 2020 in the beautiful state of California, and the results are nil. The results are none. But if you Google what new laws are coming in 2021, you'll also find out that California will no longer allow the police to wear camouflage. We actually made a law to demilitarize the police uniforms. So if you think about it, I mean, sometimes you see the police wearing, I don't know, camo pants. I kind of am more accustomed to seeing the sheriff's department, but they're in cargo pants. They're not really in camouflage. We've made a law that doesn't allow our police to utilize anything that looks or substantially similar to police, or excuse me, to military uniforms. So what makes a police officer's uniform substantially similar? They have to have two of the following three things. Number one, they have to have a badge or a star on the chest, a badge or star on the chest. Number two, a badge or star of the law enforcement agency on the arm, on the sleeve, either one side or both sides. And of course, last but not least, either the word police or sheriff in large writing across their back or somewhere else visible. If you have two of those three things, then you will not be substantially similar to a military uniform. But remember, no camo, no camo police. We made a law, and if you wear camo, we'll send the police. Let me get my cell phone. Because they're continuing to destroy the street outside, making a ton of noise with those jackhammers, second day in a row, we're gonna move offices. With a small army of contractors working to widen the street right outside my office, you gotta imagine one of the main things they're concerned about is distracted drivers. Drivers that are too busy looking at their cell phones while they go by to see what the contractors are doing. You know, the slow, the stop, whatever signs they're holding up. I mean, distracted driving really leads to a high number of accidents. I think we're all well aware of that. Currently in the state of California, if you get a ticket for distracted driving, you know, for holding your cell phone while you're driving in the car, even if you're on speakerphone doing this whole thing, speaking into that's still distracted driving. You're not supposed to be holding your cell phone. But currently, if you get a ticket for distracted driving, it's like a fix-it ticket. All you gotta do is not do it again, pay the fine. If you get a second one, same kind of thing. It's like a fix-it ticket, almost like having no front license plate where you gotta put one on, or having too dark of window tint where you have to take it off. It's just needing to fix it, but not anymore. Effective July 1, 2021, so not right away, but kind of in the midpoint of the next year, any second violation for a distracted driving infraction will count as a point. So not the first one, the first time you get a ticket for holding your cell phone while driving, we're still just gonna have you fix it. But the second one, if it happens in a 36-month period, that one's gonna cost you a point on your license, which will increase your insurance rates. So let's be honest, we all see people all the time driving with their cell phones in their hands. Definitely a dangerous practice, something you shouldn't do. But most people, I don't think they're getting pulled over for it. So if you're getting caught doing this twice in 36 months, I think you deserve that point on your license. So we talked about distracted driving, kind of infractions while the car's moving. Well, there's a new law. Well, there's an existing law that doesn't allow you to leave a child 6 years of age or under in a car unattended unless there was someone 12 years of age or older. That's actually a current existing law. But now we've added something to that law. If you see a child in an unattended car, and it doesn't seem like they're getting any ventilation. Maybe it's too hot, or, you know, East Coasters, too cold. You can now break the window of that car to rescue the child if you believe they're in imminent danger and face no liability, civil, meaning the cost, the money you have to spend to fix the window, or criminal, meaning like the violation, breaking someone else's property, right? You have no liability either way, civil or criminal, as long as you have a reasonable belief that the child is in immediate danger. Now, there's an interesting wrinkle here. As I was going over this new law, I realized there were six separate requirements you must meet as like a good Samaritan in order for this law to protect you. I had to write them down, the six of them. The six of them are, you have to confirm that the car is locked. You have to confirm that the car doors are locked, that there's no easier way to bring that child out of the vehicle. You have to have a good faith belief that you're actually needed, that this is an emergency, that you're going to rescue that child, that it's too hot or too cold, right? Number three, you have to call the police or fire department before you take action. Call 911, all right? Number four, you have to stay with the child after you remove them. You have to stay with the kid. You can't just save them and then hand them to someone else. You have to stay with that child. Number five, you can't use more force than is necessary. So in other words, if you break the window to bring the kid out, you can't break all the windows. You can't start smashing the car up just for fun. Just break what's necessary to rescue the child. And of course, last but not least, you have to turn that child over to the parent or to law enforcement immediately upon their arrival. So I started thinking, well, those six things that they have to do, that seems like a lot. It seems like a lot of different requirements. But then put yourself in the position of someone who comes across a small child in a car. Wouldn't you first check and make sure there's no easier way to open the door, easier way to get the child out of the car? Of course you would. You would probably call 911, right? Call the police, call the fire department before you start smashing windows. You wouldn't smash all the windows. When you take the child out of the car, if you went to that much, if you went that out of your way to save this child, you wouldn't just take the kid out and hand it to some stranger. You're gonna stay with that child to make sure they're safe. And of course, once law enforcement or the guardian were to show up, why would you wanna hold on to the child? You're just a good Samaritan. So, on one hand, it seems like a lot of different small requirements, but there's small requirements that I think you would sort of naturally meet. So if you see a child under the age of six unattended in a hot or cold car, go ahead and smash that window to save them, as long as you meet those requirements. We talked about some new laws for when your car is moving, for when your car is parked, and even some minimum wage. So I'm sure there's something in this episode you like, so be sure to hit the like button and subscribe while you're doing that. But we're not done with new laws yet. Thanks to Prop 17, there's a new law affecting people coming out of prison. We like to say if you do the crime, you need to do the time, but once you're done doing the time, you're not really allowed to vote. Until now, thanks to Prop 17, felons are given their right to vote back once they've completed their sentence. They did the crime, they did the time, and now they get their right to vote back. I hope you like this episode. I hope you like some of these new laws. I'm sure there's some that you don't. Make sure you comment below and let us know which ones are thumbs up and which ones are thumbs down. And we'll see you on another episode of Unbillable Soon.